mind as possible. We want to make it easy for her to go back and look at who she's played with in the past, so that during downtime she can remember, oh yeah, that person was awesome, I really should friend them. Or so that next time she looks for a group to play with, she has an easy starting point. Even providing an unobtrusive UI element that asks her if she'd like to friend people after she's grouped with them for a certain period of time can encourage this forming of social bonds. By this point, Emily's ready to advance to the final stage of our curve, social play, where the game mechanics simply become a platform to test her skill within the game's social framework. This is sort of the reigning stage of the game, and at this point the sky's the limit. The lower end of this stage is maybe simply a guild member, but on the higher end is everything from EVE Online-style conspiracies to running a wiki or a fan site. In between those extreme ends, you'll find guild leadership, which is the point at which the curtain is drawn back, and it becomes unavoidable for the player to realize that their gameplay involves overcoming social challenges even more than it involves overcoming the guild rules. If you're really looking to create this high-level social play, I'd encourage you to break down this category even further, but for our purposes, this category generally begins when the difficulty of the social tasks the player's taking on outweighs the difficulty of the mechanics. Ask anybody who's been in a good guild, and they'll tell you that the raids themselves aren't that hard. What's difficult is getting enough competent people together, teaching them all what to do, and getting them to act in concert. So, to help Emily get engaged in this aspect of social play, once again we start by offering her rewards for doing so. But here, the mechanical reward is often outweighed by the fantasy or social reward. Social reward is easier to talk about, let's start there. Prestige, fame, bragging rights, these are all social rewards, and you'll find that at this stage of the game, these matter more for many players than minor mechanical upgrades. If we can design ways to give Emily these rewards, whether it be a standing on a leaderboard, a system-wide message, or a suit of armor that lets everybody around know that she helped slay a god once, you'll draw more players like her into this level of social play than you will with any mechanical reward. Also, for many games, high-level social play plays directly into the fantasy of the game. You know when you pick up a game and you love the idea of being a character in that universe, being a hero, of helping to save the world? That's the fantasy. Often, a group of mighty heroes desperately fighting back to battle against a cataclysm of evil feels like shaping that fantasy. So don't neglect this aspect when you're constructing your engine. As to the best ways to graduate Emily into this level of play, that's a bit harder to break down, because by this point, as the community itself has come far enough to do some of the heavy lifting for us, so that they are teaching other players the ropes of endgame social play themselves. At a certain point, you really want to let the community take some ownership over the social experience. The main thing here is to cut down on iteration time for your first endgame challenges, so that if Emily's guild fails while they're learning to work as a large group, like they wipe in a raid or something, their experience isn't too frustrating and they can just get back up and try again. Okay, so at this point, Emily has completely mastered our social difficulty curve. As designers, from here on, it's all just ease of use stuff. We can try to streamline the process of finding an appropriate guild or clan or battalion to work with. We can give guild masters useful in-game guild management tools. We can even do things like starting and seeding the fan wiki for our game, so that Emily and her fellow players can take it over without having to actually create one from scratch. That about wraps it up, but one last thing. I've talked a lot about easing Emily's path as she tackles new social challenges, but it's important to note, easing doesn't mean making automatic. What you want to do is make it as easy as possible for her to do what she's trying to do and see if it works. Think of good tools and good UI in this case as analogous to good controls for mechanics, because even mechanics challenges aren't engaging without good controls. Ultimately, our goal should be to remove as many barriers between her and trying to solve the social challenges in front of her as possible. What we don't want to do is just take over and solve the challenges we're presenting before. If you look to games like Warhammer Online, the open group system basically took all the challenge out of grouping, which in turn meant that players didn't form social bonds within the game because grouping became just an anonymous automatic thing rather than a social challenge. If you have to err on this, err on the side of the game. But it's important to know all of this is not. So with that, I hope you enjoy our digression on social difficulty. Just remember, social challenges should be just as engaging as mechanical ones, and it's our job as designers to help the player get better at these challenges so we can provide them more interesting, more nuanced social challenges. See you next week. This episode, The Waiting Game, but these games aren't truly about making you wait. At least not in the Farmville reward schedule sense. These games are about starting small, starting with something that belies before experience, and slowly with patience, allowing the player to see more and more of what's really going on. Often, this unfolding involves time mechanics, delay timers, and other game functions that simply require waiting, but they are simply a means to an end, prolonging in anticipation. But before I get to that, let's first talk about why this is new, different, and downright weird. You see, all of these games defy what is traditional AAA wisdom. In AAA design, it's almost axiomatic that you grab the player with a hook. You give them a taste of what the game will be at its best, and then you push them through without any artificial pauses, without any stops, to get them to the point where you can give them the biggest experience you can for the longest amount of time possible. These unfolding games, on the other hand, take the opposite approach. They start you with almost nothing. They start you with a game that barely even looks like a game, something where there's no play at all. They give you no promise, not even a hint that the game might ever grow beyond this nascent state, and yet somehow, they expect you to keep playing. At first glance, they have no hook. They have no first beat on the engagement. So why do they work? Well, because they rely on the aesthetic of discovery in a way that few games do. They make demand of our curiosity. You see, these games do have a hook. They do indeed have a first peek on that engagement curve, but it can be deceptive because this hook isn't driven by excitement or